Okay, cool. All right, everybody, welcome. Tonight, Mobile Monday. Tonight is our developer lab. We'll be focused on improving the power and performance of your Android apps. Hashtag is Mobile Monday, and also hashtag Qualcomm for folks that are tweeting. And hey, guys in the back, if you want to have a conversation, please take it outside to the sidewalk. Thanks. Cool. My name is Mari Tapia. I'm your host for tonight. Also president and chair of Mobile Monday. So I've been convening the mobile developer community for 17 years now. Yes, mobile developers for 17 years. Back when we had monochrome mobile browsers, many of you know like phone.com or OpenWave and even Microsoft at the time, right? Very early on. And how many of you guys know when we had our first color screen in mobile? Does anyone know? Anybody have a guess for which year?
Which year?
North America. And it was a Swedish company that was actually developed it.
2003.
What was the phone?
Nokia?
No. It was an Ericsson T48. That was 2003, 2004. That was the first time North America had a color screen phone. And it had a D-pad. So there was no touch screen. So give me an idea. Lots of, that was almost less than, a little more than 10 years ago. So tonight's agenda, basically I'm going to pull a slide in a moment. How many people here first time tonight? All right, cool. How many people here find us on Meetup? And how many people get my newsletter? How many guys? Cool. Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
I go through the Mobile Monday overview. We'll have presentation by Qualcomm, and then we'll have, I think we might have one demo come up. And if you guys want to hang out, so networking, we should be wrapped up by it. So, Mobile Monday is a multi-headed dragon. But I can be in Silicon Valley, Silicon Beach, and Silicon Alley. So it was like, what is Silicon Alley? That's New York City. And actually, the really cool, just lower midtown area in Chelsea, which pretty much 80% of the tech in New York is based. So this actually event will be replicated in Santa Monica, July, if you guys are interested. And also next Monday, we're having the developer lab in New York. You guys have friends out there, take a look. But there's actually a meetup for each one of these different cities if you guys are interested in traveling. Overall, we're about 30,000 developers and entrepreneurs. So we pretty much put together an event almost every week. Worldwide locations. So Mobile Monday exists in about 140 different cities, so Paris, Munich, Berlin, from Tel Aviv to Tokyo. So at any given time, even on tonight, there are actually quite a few other Mobile Monday cities happening, having some community. So who are you guys? So about 27% of our member database is someone who writes code. What do they say they write code? About 33 says they're business development sales, so externally focused. And about 33 is product and marketing. A little bit of VC, and we have, how many designers? Any designers? Once in a while we get to do the corner, like one or two. And then also a little bit of media. Who writes code? How many people write code? Say they write code for a living. Okay. Product? Any folks in product? Marketing? Cool. Awesome. So what do we do? So we do monthly topics. So tonight is our developer lab. So this event is meant for people who write code, technical session. We'll learn something tonight, right? Or that's open to workshop. And we also have a meetup, which is probably 2 to 3 times bigger than what you guys have here tonight. And then we also do VIP invite-only roundtable dinners for the executive levels. We are sponsored by industry, so industry supports us, and so we're able to do these events in all the different cities. And then also where to find is mobilemonday.us, and you'll find the events for New York, Los Angeles, and here. Mobile Monday Silicon Valley on the meetup, You also have a Facebook page. If you do follow us on Facebook, you will get free tickets or highly discounted tickets to conferences, things like that. So it's a good thing to follow us. We don't spam, basically. I use Facebook for announcements. And also, if you're on a meetup, I also send emails out. So if you're subscribed to an organizer's email list, you'll get a lot of notifications. And also, we tape these, so we have over 70, about 6 years of history on YouTube. So we have tons of content that you might want to take a look at past and present. Also, I'd like to thank our event sponsors. So we have Qualcomm. Thanks, give a round of applause for them for the beer and pizza. And we've got also, thanks to folks at Galvanize for letting us host the event here tonight. And also, IBM is our year-long sponsor, and basically allow us to go into the business as well. So thank you. Without further ado, I'll introduce Rick from Qualcomm, and we'll get started.
All right. So tonight we're going to be talking about profiling, how to improve the performance and power consumption of applications. So as a developer, there's some compelling reasons why you'd want to profile your app. First thing is, performance matters. I'm sure you've seen that hashtag before. As a developer, you want your app to be competitive, you want it to be fast, responsive. One nice thing about profiling is it can help you to identify bottlenecks. And once you identify them, of course, it's much easier to fix them. You can also see if your app is a CPU or GPU bound, which is important. You may have heard the term throttling. It's very easy to see if your app is throttling, causing the processor to throttle. The reason that is a concern is if you're throttling, the temperature goes up and the performance goes down. Obviously, that's something that you don't want to happen. It's very easy to see if it's happening. It's also relatively easy to address if you do have an issue with that. Something that I'm very interested in, and I'm sure some of you are as well, as a consumer, I want to make sure that this works all day and not just 8-hour days. Many of us work longer than that. So I want to make sure that there's not apps that are using way too much power. So as a developer, you want to make sure that your app is not one of those apps that's going to do that and drop the battery life on a consumer's device. So it's actually very easy to see how much power your mobile device is using, and it's actually very easy to see how it compares to other devices. We'll show you that tonight. Especially if you're a game developer, frame rates are really important. Again, it's very easy to do that. A lot of people don't do it, probably because they don't know how, but it's easy to do. You can see if your app is using all the resources in addition to all the cores of the process. You've got a GPU, you've got a DSP, and you can see if it's using it efficiently. You can also see if it's using the network and the cellular radio efficiently. That's another thing that can waste battery power if you don't use it efficiently, so it's important. And another thing is, I'm constantly surprised how much data some games and apps use. Sometimes, I've seen games that use over 100 megabyte a minute.
Wow.
So if you have kids and they're complaining about how their data's gone, if they're using some of these apps, that could be one of the reasons. The other thing that's interesting, I find it's not always the app itself. I find that oftentimes it's the ads or the analytics or other things that the developer is not necessarily responsible for directly, but it's very easy to see exactly how much data your app's using. So everything here we're going to go through. And of course, there's a lot of other benefits. I'm going to kind of start with the profiling for dummies. And then Kevin's going to kind of do a deeper dive on things. Before the event tonight, we asked developers to submit some apps. We got 3 submissions. Sadly, most of the apps that we got were pretty good. So So we're going to feature some of them, but I'm going to spend some time on apps that maybe aren't so good, because I think they're actually better for demonstration. We're going to start with, as I said, a very easy way to profile. In the past, you needed software that was maybe not that easy to use. In some cases, it was expensive. Even after you had the software and you profiled it, you have these elaborate graphs and all these things, it wasn't quite clear to most developers how to use the information. Okay, this really interesting chart, but what do I do with it? Is this good, is it bad? How do I act on this information to address issues? So we set out last year to try to create a new type of app, something that any developer could use, something you could use very quickly. Our goal was 60 seconds. Developers are very busy, but everyone has 60 seconds. And it's surprising how much information you can get in 60 seconds. And of course, we're going to show you in just a minute. And the idea is very simple how it works. Let me see if I can find my tablet here. So I'm going to see if I can get this so we can see the tablet. And also, I've got a Chrome plugin called Visor. It's kind of cool because it will, in theory, display the screen from my Nexus 7 tablet. Looks like it's working. So let's hide this. All right. So I just want to jump right in and show you how you profile. Everything you're going to show tonight is free. The Qualcomm apps are all available from qualcommdeveloper.com, developer.qualcomm.com. We're also going to show some other apps from other companies. But we'll start with TuneUpKit because it's very easy to use. So I've downloaded the app and I launch it. A very simple UI. And effectively, it's like an app launcher. So it's showing everything that's on my device. One of the reasons I like Nexus devices is they don't have a lot of extra apps that you don't need. In fact, before the demo tonight, I installed some of the apps that people gave us to profile. But before the demo tonight, I think I only have like 5 apps installed on this tablet. That's good because if you have a carrier device that's got 40 to 70 apps, each one of those apps is consuming resources. They're all pinging your network, and that consumes power, and it makes it harder for you to determine what your app is doing. So it's nice if you can kind of isolate things. All right, so enough talk, let's profile an app. As I said, the ones that were submitted actually look pretty good. So I'm gonna pick one that maybe isn't so good. The ironic thing is I find that many of the top 20 apps in the Google Play Store have serious issues, which is a little ironic because these are big companies with big teams and a lot of money. But I'll just pick a top 10 news app. We will pretend we don't see the names up there. Hopefully no one's here from that. And the idea is very simple. You just use the app like you normally would. So I'm going to browse, I'm going to look for a story, I'll click on something. And effectively, this app is effectively a web page launcher. It's really not doing much. So I would not expect this to be a very resource-intensive app. Whereas I would expect a extreme game, a first-person shooter, or a driving game, or a VR app to use more resources. And I have this tune-up kit set right up now for a 60-second duration, which is the minimum that we recommend. And so any second here, we should see TuneUpKit. It's in the background when I'm profiling. When 60 seconds is up, it should come to the foreground.
This is before you launch the video, right?
So I was in TuneUpKit. I could see the apps that were available. I clicked on this news app, and then TuneUpKit goes to the background. And now it comes back. It's always interesting in the demo how 60 seconds seems like eternity. I apologize for the pixelation. It's getting better. So the idea is at a glance, we want to make it easy for people to see if there's an issue. So I can see in this particular case, power is green is good. It's below average. average for a CPU, right now I'm comparing this app to the top 20 apps in Google Play. Average for CPU usage would be at the 50% line. So this is double the average top 20 app. And a lot of the top 20 apps are games, so again, you'd expect to use that to be very light on resources. GPU is below average, as expected. Thermals, no big problem. Data, higher than expected, that's why it's yellow. So at a glance, you're really looking for red and yellow to see if there's an issue there, very simple. And then the idea is you want to scroll down and kind of look at see what's happening here. So I can see this app is using an average of about 25% of the CPU, just this one app. It's maxing at about 84%. The system is actually peaking at 99%. It looks like it's pretty well threaded. Most of the cores are utilized. Power is higher than expected. 2.2 watts for a news app is a lot of power. And then we're seeing a peak of 5.8 watts, which again, higher than expected. Data-wise, in this run, it didn't use a lot. I have seen in other runs use a lot more. And one of the things, if you use this yourself, because we are charging this device, it tends to affect the accuracy of the power and the thermal readings. So that might be one of the reasons why this app actually looks relatively good here. I did a test earlier and I got much less good results. I got a lot of red and orange and in fact a lot more power. The next thing that we really recommend you do if you run this app is you want to compare it with a similar app. So if you're a news app, you select news and magazines. Now I'm comparing it with the top 20 news apps in Google Play. And you can see now actually the story gets much worse. So whereas before some of those were green, now we're seeing even more red and more yellow. So I apologize for the pixelation. Eventually it will get clearer. Of course, if you have a game, you want to compare it. I have kind of casual games and extreme games. So the point is you want to compare it apples to apples. Yes?
So is the power consumption that's negative for a news app that you described a function of the image type or some other category that is over the top on the power consumption?
Sure. So as I said, this is a good example for power because we're charging. But if you are on battery power, what we do is we read the power directly from the power management IC. So it is very accurate. It is system power, it's not app power. So that's why it's important that you make sure there's no apps in the background, make sure you don't have a lot of apps. But it is very helpful. You will see it's repeatable if you do, I'll talk a little bit about best practices later. It is fairly repeatable. And the best part is you can compare it with other apps, which I'll show you this morning. Yes?
The data that
It's a really good question. So he said, does it belong to the app or is it just this app? It varies. So power is system, data is per app, CPU is per app, temperature is system. So it kind of varies depending on what you're testing. But as I said, even the system measurements are still useful if you can kind of isolate it so you don't know what running. There were some other questions in the back.
I was double checking here. Are we on a wide area network when you're doing this, I hope? Or local area network? With this ASUS device?
Yeah, I don't know much about the network here.
No, on your device, when you're doing the test, are you using a wide area network?
Oh, so
or a local area network?
The visor, you're asking about pixelation?
No, I'm talking about your ASUS device that you're actually doing the testing on.
Talking about tablet. The tablet is powered by Wi-Fi or cellular data.
This tablet is Wi-Fi only. It does support cellular, but I don't have a SIM in it right now. And then I have the USB in the laptop, and then I have Visor, which is loading the app as well. So not the best test, but it does allow us to see.
So this testing has nothing to do with Qualcomm chipsets?
Correct. Okay. Yeah. And this is focused on software. Okay. Question there?
Thank you, Rick. Looks great, but what about the widgets and the ground services? Does this application profile? widgets?
Yeah. What was that question? The what?
So what about the widgets? Because it's really popular on Android, install widgets, for example, if it's a web app. Widgets is so the most popular thing which user install. So if you use weather, you only use weather widget. You do not open the app.
This particular app is designed to test other apps. There's an app I'm going to show you in a minute that's more focused on network, and it would work with a website or a plugin or other types of apps. But this is specifically designed to test other apps.
So about for background services, these apps?
This would not be the best app to do that. One more question, then we'll move on.
So when you're comparing the data with another app, you have the data for other apps already?
Yes, let me show you. So the averages are based on the top 20 by category. The nice thing about averages is they're not subjective, they're objective. We're not saying is an app good or bad, we're saying compared to the top 20 apps in this category, you're better or worse. And then what we really encourage is that someone saves the results and then they actually find a similar app. So if you have Need for Speed, which is a driving game, you're going to want to compare it with Escalade or whatever the other extreme driving game is. And that's really where you want to end up. So let me show you an example of that. Let me wake up the tablet here. Okay. So you can see the categories you can compare it to. So you save the data by hitting the little floppy disk in the top. I saved one earlier, so I'm going to actually load that. So I'm going to swipe right, and I can see compare sessions. And I can see the top one is this particular news app, and the one below that, I just did a search for news in the Google Play, so it was another highly rated app. I don't know at a glance if it's better or worse, but this is going to tell us. So if I rotate this sideways, let's see if we, hopefully it's going to, if not, we can still get the data, but it's not responding. But if you rotate it sideways, you're going to get percentage differences, which is really useful, but we can still do this. So I can see the difference between the app that we loaded and the other popular app. It's consuming about 3 times the CPU resources. And what else is standing out here? Definitely a lot more CPU. We can scroll down here. Even the GPU frequency, it's clocked higher, which is not expected for a news app. Power is significantly higher. And data is actually a little bit lower. So again, you really want to, at the end, really compare apples to apples. You'll find an app that you consider is close to yours and then do a direct comparison to that. Yes?
Are you able to create your own benchmarks? So let's say, for example, you have an app and you want to compare it to 4 specific apps. Are you able to create that group and then run the test and then visualize them?
Currently, that's a great question. It was something that we wanted to do and we kind of ran out of time. So currently we have the preset categories and then you can compare an app, but you can't actually create a category. You can do it kind of in a manual way, but there's no easy way to do that. And then, yes?
That category data, how often is that updated?
Roughly every 30 days.
30 days?
Yeah, we find that actually the popular categories don't change very much. The order changes, so Facebook's number 1 week, and it's number 3 another week, but it's mostly the same apps in the popular categories. We had originally thought we'd see a lot more kind of rotation of new apps, but you don't see too much of that. Yes?
Does it vary from devices to devices? Because
yes, that's actually a really good question. So the question was, does it vary from device to device? This software is intended to be used on any device. So it's very meaningful and it doesn't matter what your device is. It doesn't matter if it's an Nexus 6 or 5 or 7, but the point is you want to be consistent. So use your device. Doesn't work with that one yet, but So for example, my device is a Nexus 6, so I would want to compare app A with Nexus 6 and app B with Nexus 6. It would be meaningless to consume one app, compare one app on this device with that tablet or another device. As I said, it's testing software, not the system resources per se. There's other apps, it's definitely not a benchmark. And there's other apps that, it's actually very good at telling you who makes the best benchmarks, but it's definitely not a benchmark. Yes?
So what about auto tests? For example, if I would like to test every build of my application.
This particular app isn't scriptable. We have a version of this called Trepin that is scriptable. You can do automated testing. So again, this is kind of a starting point. So let me move ahead here because I want to make sure that Kevin has enough time for everything he wants to cover. So that's just a very quick introduction. I thought it would be interesting to kind of talk about real-world results. And this was done in a very careful, controlled manner. So I've got some examples of good apps at the top. So iHeartRadio, under a watt power, that's system power. That's everything on the device, including the screen, which is turned up to 100% brightness. So almost no CPU load, almost no GPU load. CPU temperature is very low. Shazam, substantially higher, which makes me think that iHeartRadio is using the DSP for audio playback, which is more efficient, saves a lot of power. Something that's fairly easy to do on any Android app. But still, the first two are good apps, definitely. I want to make that clear. Super bright flashlight is interesting. There's a bunch of these apps, and they all seem to have issues. One would not expect an app that turns on the strobe, you know, basically it's a flashlight. Would not use a lot of resources, but uses 1.5 watts of power, uses a lot of CPU. In fact, it uses more CPU than Real Racing 3. That's one of the most intense driving games. So there's something going on there. I don't know what they're doing, but they're using a ton of CPU. Uses a ton of GPU. And also look at the processor temperature. High processor temperature equals high power. So this is going to kill your battery life.
Could that be malware?
I wouldn't want to speculate, but there's definitely something going on. There have been articles about these apps that I don't know specifically about this one. There are ones that have had issues like that. Snapchat's another one. My kids just absolutely love Snapchat. But if you care about battery life, Snapchat uses more battery life than Real Racing. If you care about battery life, that's one app that will just kill it for you. NBC News is the one that I showed here. You can see in a control test, it uses more power than Real Racing. It uses almost twice the CPU as Real Racing. It's a news app. It's words on a page that you scroll. I didn't play video, I didn't do anything fancy. I looked at one page. CNN, you can see, is a much better example of an app. So, you know, one quarter the CPU, almost no GPU. And then we look at the CPU temp, we can see a huge difference between a well-behaved app and a not-so-well-behaved app. Crossy Road is not what I would call an extreme game. But it actually uses more GPU than Real Racing, and it uses more power than Real Racing. So there are big differences between apps. And again, as a developer, you know, you want to make sure that this is obviously an app that they've really done a good job optimizing resources. I would expect that app to use more power than they have, but they've really, really done a great job. Frame rate's another thing that, especially if you are a game developer, is something that you care about. We recently added the feature into this app tuning kit. And in order to use it, you want to install a companion app, which is Snapdragon Profiler that runs on PC or Mac or Linux. And basically, once you've done that, you launch it, and you have to change one setting to do that. But long story short, you run your app. What I wanted to do is do an app that was repeatable. So we have a GPU test app called the Demo Test. I ran it. And this app is intended to stress the GPU, which it does. So it's the frame rate is about 150 frames a second, which is very high, and that's what it's intended to do. When I ran TuneUpKit, I see an average frame rate of about 111, median of 120, and a max of 160. So that corresponds very closely with what we're seeing on the app. So it shows that we're reading the data accurately, which is no surprise because we're reading it directly from the graphic driver. By comparison, I launched another very popular app that game developers use to read frame rate, and I found that it was not as accurate. So here, on this run, it was running at 153 frames, but they show a peak frame rate of about 50. So they are significantly off. In fact, they're showing a frame rate that's three times lower than the actual frame rate. They're also showing a median frame rate that's way off. So the reason is they don't have the access to the GPU to read directly off the driver like we do. But as a developer, you'd be better off using software that does have that access because you're going to get much more accurate readings. So just want to do a time check here. I'm kind of winding up on mine, and we're going to do a deeper dive with Kevin. Just some best practices in case you want to use this app on your own. I talked already about make sure to close the background apps. It's extremely important. If you don't do that, you will not get reproducible results. So, and I recommend, I have devices like this that I just use for testing, so I pretty much uninstall everything I'm not using. It really helps. This is very important too. Don't start profiling until after an app is finished loading. And there's two ways you can do that. What I like to do with games is I'll basically launch the game. Some games take a minute, two, three to launch. And I'll let them do their updates and do all this stuff. When it's all done, I'll just stop it. I'll go back to TuneUpKit. And then I will launch it from TuneUpKit. And that way, when I start profiling, I'm going to get meaningful data. I won't get a bunch of data installing updates on the app, and I'll get better results. We also have a kind of delay that you can put in on TuneUpKit, so if you know that your app takes 20 seconds to load, you just put a 20-second delay, and then it won't start capturing data until 20 seconds. Beware of the state of your phone. Mobile phones have a lot of things happening in the background. There's a lot of things happening, so don't expect to get repeatable scores from day to day. So if you're comparing apps, compare app A, do app B. That way the state of your phone is going to be very similar. Throw out runs that are substantially higher or lower than others. It's good to test with devices that don't have a ton of apps running. Watch the temperature of your processor and battery. If you're benchmarking something like an extreme game or a benchmark, you're going to see the temperature go up. So if you did two passes back to back, that wouldn't be a good result because the processor's hot, the battery's hot, the device is hot, it could be throttling, it's going to affect your results. So what I do is when I'm doing things like that, I'll have a fan running, and I'll just put the device in front of the fan for 20 seconds, and it actually cools it off pretty quickly, and that way I get better results. Don't connect your device to USB if you want accurate power. Don't profile when your battery drops below 20% because it will drop the frequency. Don't use the back button when you're profiling, just let it run in the background. And be consistent. So if I'm testing Facebook, I want to do the same thing with Facebook I'm doing with another social media app. So you want it to be as consistent as possible in what you're doing. As I said, TuneUpKit's starting point, it's not the end all. It's a great way to kind of flag problems. It's very easy to use. Kevin's going to talk about a much more deeper dive that's going to show you things like the correlation between different resources. We talked about CPU throttling. Here's a great example. So we're running a very graphically intensive app. This is one we use internal to Qualcomm to really stress things. After 15 minutes, the temperature of the processor rises to 65 degrees centigrade. Not a problem for the processor. It can run at 85, 90 degrees centigrade. So you're never gonna worry about it burning up. but it does have an impact. So what happens is every processor has what they call limits management. It says, well, this is higher than normal, and if it keeps on going up for an hour, I might have a problem. So it makes an adjustment. You can see the frequency of the four cores here. Here's kind of the four, and it drops it down. You see a direct correlation here to the temperature. As the frequency of the cores drop, the temperature drops. In fact, it happens very quickly. So after 1 minute, we see it drop over 10 degrees, and then we see the GPU utilization, which is right here, very high here, it drops here, and then within 1 minute, we see it recover. So at a glance, we can see a lot of information. We can see throttling occurring. We can see when it occurs. It can help us determine what caused it. And then we can see when it recovers. And there are some easy ways to actually address issues like this. We have a SDK called Symphony, and it lets you do things like say, I only want to use the little cores, or I want to use the four little cores and only two of the big cores, not all four big cores. Or I want to limit certain things, so I can limit the frame rate, I can limit anything. So by doing that, it's very easy to address issues like this. So that's probably a good, I'm going to hold off on error just because I want to make sure Kevin has enough time for his. But I think that's a good transition to some of the things you can do with step rating profiling. You want to do the demo quick demo? Do we have our developer here that,
yes,
come around. So. Oh, yes. And while you're getting set up, we're going to take a question.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I'm a little bit surprised about your suggestion to be in airplane mode. I mean, wouldn't you want to know how, you know, what network requests are being made? And the radio is the biggest consumer of power.
It is. And it depends on what the app does. So normally what I do is I will go to airplane mode if I'm not testing the cellular radio. I'll go to airplane mode and then I will turn Wi-Fi back on. And the main reason I do that is I'm assuring that I'm not going to get updates, software updates. Because sometimes the Android OS will be doing housekeeping or updates or things in the background. So you want to make sure that's not happening. This does a good job of testing the cellular radio. The other app I mentioned before, Trepid, will actually show you all the mobile states. It will show you if the radio is in the idle state. It will show you if it's in the high power state. It will show you if it's recovered. There's kind of a middle state. There's actually seven different states. It will show you every single state. And it will show you the power it's using in every state. So it's extremely useful to determine how your app is using the radio. Is it keeping it awake too long? The other one that, if we have time, I'll show you is AT&T Aero. Extremely useful for diagnosing network issues. Great app. It's another app that's free, very easy to use. So I'm going to turn over the microphone here, and we're going to do a quick demo, and then Kevin's going to do this and stuff.
Hello, everyone. My name is Nima Kaviani, and I'm an engineer with IBM. And I'm also helping a company called RoboChip, which is developing and chatbot and developer framework. So basically, I'm sure you're all familiar with the idea of chatbots and with Facebook introducing their messenger bots in F8 and a lot of other companies also jumping on the bandwagon. So what RoboChip tries to do is to try to make it easier for developers to develop chatbots and also for business owners to develop chatbots. Obviously, the idea is that rather than having fragmented conversations with customers, businesses can have a single instance of their conversations with all their clients, and that makes it easier for them to connect to their users, track problems, and respond to issues that clients have. So, mobile messaging apps are very prevalent, actually. There is 75% of internet users that are already using messaging apps in one way or another. And in total, there's close to 2 billion messaging app users in the world. So without further ado, I'm just going to jump to the platform and show what it does exactly. Before I do that, with a show of hands, how many of you are familiar with the mobile messaging app called Telegram? Okay, cool. How many of you have it installed on your phones? Okay, cool. So the demo that I'm going to show you works both with Facebook Messenger and Telegram, but it's probably easier to find the bot on Telegram because Facebook has a little bit of a problem approving messaging bots. So what I'm going to show you, and you don't see it obviously on that platform. So this is Robochi, and obviously in Robochi you can create bots, and you can, Robochi supports different types of bots, Facebook bots, Telegram bots, Kick, Slack, and other ones. But the one part that's important about it and interesting about it is that you can create flows of interactions with customers and clients. So I think it's quite timely for us to create a very easy and simple flow, and I'm going to call it the Vote US flow. Let's say you want to ask your users a simple question. And I have a typo there, but I'm not going to worry about it much. Okay. And so I want it to be a poll that I'm going to send to all my users. So I create a simple flow, basically saying that I want to have two simple buttons and ask this question from all my users. I'm not going to worry about the description for now. Some settings. And let's see if I want to. Okay. So I create a template. And I'm going to add bots to the template. I'm going to add a Telegram bot, and I'm going to add a Facebook bot. So, for those of you who have Telegram, you can simply go to your app and search for Robochi demo bot. Right? And I call this, if I look at the details, I call this Vote US. So here, if I type Vote US, you see the flow that I created gets propagated to the users, and obviously I'm going to vote for Hillary. And if I look at the charts, you see the charts get updated very quickly without the users having to install any app. You can broadcast it to all users. Now, this is, we bought it across different platforms, so I'm going to show you that it is very similar on Facebook Messenger too. So, searching for Robochi demo, I'm going to send the same message. So I get the similar question, and this time, even though I don't really like it, try Trump. And I go to the charts, refresh it, and you see it very quickly gets updated. And you, as I said, you can do it across multiple platforms. And the flow can get way more complicated than this. You can have inputs from users, you can connect it to web services, you can ask for user information that they have on their phones. For example, Telegram allows you to ask for, to retrieve users' phone numbers, etc., so you can do authentication and other stuff through it. So we're hoping that Robochi can actually help businesses connect to their customers a lot easier than they used to. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, Kevin's up. I'm going to remind everyone, anyone who asks a question at the end, if you come up, we have, as I said, three drones and two Beats headsets, and we will figure a way to get those out. So make sure if you ask a question, you come up at the end.
They get dressed before
then.
10.
Yeah, the demo you're going to see has been worked on today. It's Visual Studio. So the reason Robochi just presented is because Mario had asked for developers to submit apps. I think we had 3 responses. And unfortunately, when I dug into them, we didn't really see that much. Usually when you do that, you hope to see something to kind of teach a lesson or something along those lines to teach about the tool, but we didn't really get that. So instead, I figured could show a little bit about the tool and kind of what we look for. Got a couple different apps that I can show and kind of, you know, just general use as a developer or anybody interested in the performance of mobile applications on Snapdragon. What do you want to watch out for? So I don't know how well this is showing up, but sometimes I wonder about our color scheme for presentations, but this is Snapdragon Profiler. So Snapdragon Profiler is what we call a system profiler. It allows you to, sorry, I'm trying to find a spot for this. Come in here. It allows you to dive into what's happening with the Snapdragon chip on Android devices. We do intend to support more than Android into the future, other mobile OSs that are coming out in the next few years. But right now, this is what we have. So when you start off, you really just connect to your device. So I have a Galaxy S7 here connected, and I'll go ahead and connect. Once it's connected, you'll see the log cat there in the bottom starting to spit off the data. I'm gonna go ahead and close this, it's a little distracting. And what we have are 3 main modes in the Snapdragon Profiler. So we have our real-time mode, which allows you to view, as it sounds, real-time data. Trace capture, if you're familiar with Android SysTrace, what we've done is taken Android SysTrace and built around that. And then we have what we call snapshot capture. Is there anybody that works on graphics or games today? Okay, not very popular. So snapshot capture is useful if you're doing graphics programming or games where you're looking to squeeze every bit of performance out of the GPU. I'll show that to you just to kind of show you everything that Profiler has. So the first one is real time, and this brings up our data sources view over here on the left, as we call it. And this section on the top left is all the processes that are running. These aren't necessarily all the processes. This is all the user space processes. So this is all your standard Android applications. You asked the question about the widgets. I checked into that right after you asked, because that's never even something that we thought about. And yes, so I installed, I'm a fan of Weather Underground for my weather app. So I installed Weather Underground, put a widget up, and you can see that it shows up in the process list. So you can select it, and kind of went out of order there, but I selected it, and right here we get the per process metrics. Depending on the app, you'll get different metrics. So in this case, the app's not using any special APIs or anything that we hook into. So you get your CPU, your memory, and your network data. Below that, I'm not sure if everybody can see, I'm trying to get out of the way. Below that is what we call system metrics. Rick had alluded to that earlier, where you're looking at per process data and you're looking at system data. Some data is just, it's system data. We can't get it at a process level. And so that system section is all that. So you got your different information about the CPU cores. We do hook into the DSP for newer chipsets. Galaxy S7 is one of those, the Snapdragon 820. GPU data, network data, power data, thermal data, and so on. So I'll go ahead and throw out the temperature. And Rick had talked a bit about the thermal throttling situation. I'm not going to try to replicate that. That screenshot that he showed was actually from a device sitting on my desk for about 15, 20 minutes running one of our high-powered graphics demos. And the device was scorching when that happened. So here, nothing's really going on. I think the range is pretty small. You're going to see little spikes. Most likely what that is network. I think somebody mentioned you use your LTE or 3G modem, and that's where your temperature is typically going to rise. And that's kind of lesson number one. Be careful about how much data you send, or how often you spin up the modem, because every time you spin up that modem, your temperature is going to spike. All right, so nothing's happening right now on the phone. It's just sitting on the home screen. I'll go ahead and drop in four frequencies, and I'll change the graph. So it's just a stat graph showing cumulative, but I can hover over and see per core roughly how much. And that 300 megahertz is about right when you're sitting on the home screen. You're going to see most of the cores hanging out around there, and then all these little spikes are going to be your background services doing something. So you can see it's not necessarily huge, but you're getting 1 to 2 degrees centigrade every time those cores ramp up just because of background services. And this is just stuff happening every day on everybody's devices. Throw up the DSP. That's a fairly new thing for us, and it's kind of interesting to see. The DSP is used most of the time for audio processing. I think it primarily comes from doing phone calls, doing the audio for phone calls and things. But these days, it's starting to be used for more things like VR. For offloading tasks from the CPU onto the DSP. The DSP can execute at, say, 800 megahertz, really kind of low volume type data processing. GPU, throw up GPU utilization, just so now we're looking at CPU, GPU, and DSP. And we'll just start with that. So like I said, sitting on the home screen, everybody's just kind of doing the processing right now. And I'll spin up the app, or the mobile app, which we didn't show. So I don't know really exactly how this app works, but I'm going to spin it up anyway. So Robochi, is the mobile app, is running. And you can see the app startup sequence kicks on the core frequencies, and temperature goes up. But the app really doesn't do much as far as there's not a lot of updating going on or anything like that. Really interesting is that DSP utilization just tanking. Not really sure why that might happen, but the spike on the GPU is actually the screen updating with the app. So it's nothing really the app is doing, that's just Android. So I have Robochi selected. Oops, sorry, I do not have Robochi selected. That was the weather up. That's your weather widget. Which, by the way, it looks like it pings home about every 5 minutes. I checked. All right, let's try that again. All right, so this is the Robochi app running. Looks like it's doing something, maybe have a small thread update going on. Something I thought was really interesting is that all of our OpenGLES data shows up when I select the app. Are you doing any OpenGLES rendering? Didn't think so, but I kind of wonder if that's a bug on our part. All right, so the last two I just threw up was the amount of data that's being sent and received over the network. So just an example, like I said, I don't see really anything going wrong with this app or it really doing anything major, but I'll do a refresh. And you can see the bottom one is your send, the middle one here is your receive. And you can see the CPU processing that occurred at that time. And that's why this app is so exciting for profile. There's not that much going on. Yeah, question.
Can you pick, can you like monitor like two apps at the same time, or only single?
You can. I'll show that in a second.
Okay. A couple questions. One is, can you see the effect of a GC pause? That's a big issue with games. And then there's this ongoing debate about the usefulness of the big little approach. You know, Apple has said two cores is enough to get, you know, you want to emphasize, you know, single threaded performance versus with the big little approach, which is, you know, a couple high powered and low powered and trying to consider. But though I don't think Android's scheduling like that right now. They're not sending jobs between one set of cores and others, I don't think.
Yeah, so on the cores, these core IDs, CPU 0, 1, 2, 3, right now we're not necessarily identifying whether they're big or little. But if you look up the system, look up the information on the chip itself that's running on the device, then you can map those IDs to which core it is. So you can use that information to know, you know, whether you're running big or little. And Rick mentioned Symphony as well. You can actually, with Symphony, you can peg a thread to a specific core. That way the Android scheduler doesn't switch on you. So there's some optimizations there. And in the trace view with CPU scheduling, Android SysTrace, you can see a lot of that information too. I forgot the first part of your question.
GC pause.
You can, maybe not necessarily in this real-time view though, I think it's, again, going back to some of the SysTrace data that we get and some of the data that we'll be adding in future versions where that'll be a little more apparent.
Yeah. Have you noticed any trends or patterns between native apps and apps that were made using phone gaps?
I don't think I've looked at that enough to say I've seen a trend. You know, it's interesting, a lot of times my team, the types of things that we deal with are gonna be more in their real-time performance type applications. Things I watch out for, like for Bochi, right? Like, I'm looking for, is the network being pinged every 2 seconds? You know, a year ago, Facebook's version of their mobile app on Android pinged home every second. And I was doing this sort of thing at a conference, and I used their app to demo, and it was beautiful. It was the most perfect demo I could ever have, because the temperature was rising over time, because they're using the wireless, you know, every second. And a week later, it was fixed. But you know, those are the kinds of things that we absolutely, the first layer, looking for that network data, because you're spinning up the modem uses a lot of power. After that, you start to look for a balance between the CPU, the GPU, and the DSP, depending on what type of app it is. You know, Rabochi's not doing a lot, so it's not necessarily the best example, but if I kind of close Rabochi out and, say, start up this demo app that I have that actually pegs everything, you can see the temperature's rising, and you can see that the cores, their frequencies are much higher. 2 and 3 are maxed out. And you can see the GPUs getting busy. So this is actually more of a gaming type graphics application, very intense app. And we purposely wrote it initially, so increase the brightness here. Purposely wrote it by default as a poor performing app. And this is kind of a good example of one where see all these like spikes that are happening with the GPU in particular. And it's not so much on the CPU side, because the CPU side is really kind of pegged. Utilization. So this is the CPU port utilization that's really difficult to see. Need a better algorithm for picking colors. Sounds random. So the utilization looks like across all four cores is roughly in the 80% range. The VSD utilization is kind of bouncing around a bit. The GPU utilization is bouncing around. So that's just generally not what you want. I have a button here to optimize. That bounces around, I can equate it to like thrashing. Basically, cores or threads are going kind of across cores, pushing too much data through the bus. You know, just a lot of kind of bad things going on. So I'll go ahead and hit the optimize button. And you should notice, unless things have gotten so terrible that it's unrecoverable, but temperature should start to drop as time passes. And you see the GPU utilization kind of leveled out. That's probably the most important part, is that there's not these GPU stalls that are affecting the performance. You asked the question about being able to do more than one app.
Is it optimizing?
Yeah, there is the temperature slowly trickling down. So there's the two different apps. They're both using the background. You can see it is every once in a while doing something. Really just freeze the real time data.
So quick question, how big is the Symfony runtime? And when you're managing these multiple threads, is there any way to throttle back? Or have it intelligently throttle back automatically different threads when they're going on in the background?
Symfony's a little more manual right now than that. So it will give you the information, and then you need to
decide
what to do with it. And one of the things that I believe is either out or coming out soon with Symfony is you can write code for one SoC component, and Symfony will take that and put it on whatever's most available. So let's say you write a compute kernel for the GPU. If the DSP is available, Symfony will take that and put it on the DSP. It kind of does that automatically.
Yeah. I think it's called polykernels where you write once and run anywhere.
Yeah. Right now you kind of need to control that yourself, but it provides a simple interface to do that. Yeah.
What should the way you do it?
This is whatever Samsung is using on their GSM.
Would you recommend to run on the profile of the same or the most popular Android?
You can use it with KitKat and above or later. We generally use it, we actually recommend developers use Nexus devices. That way you have a lot more control over Android. Like Samsung installs a lot of Samsung stuff. I think using things like the Samsung device is great for kind of real world testing, but just pure development, Nexus is just much easier to work with. Because you can update the system image and revert back to older Android versions or whatever you want to do, much easier. Whereas with OEMs, they control the pipeline, they control when you're going to get your updates, and so on. And we actually have drivers on the website that you can download and get the most up-to-date stuff if you're looking to fix something in particular.
I have a question to the previous presentation of how you pulled out a frame rate based on what you mean from the device driver. So now when I climb frame rate developing an app in Unity, it goes back to think what's coming out of H-rays. There's all buffer there, and that's where everybody quote-unquote is pointing out, and it's the baseline. So basically, that's actually right, and you would be wrong, you know, because it's, basically industry accept the baseline for what the frame rate is. So how do you reconcile that?
I would think the graphic driver is going to be the more accurate, just because there's bottlenecks in the system where they make happen at 30 or 60. The middleware that doesn't mean that the graphic driver isn't got other stuff going on. So I don't know how you can get more accurate than reading it directly from the driver.
A factor of five that you...
I would say it's a factor of three,
I think. Three, I mean, that's still...
It varies on the app.
Way off.
Yeah, it's hard to see. Do you have more to add to that? The one situation where you wouldn't want to use Snapdragon Profiler or TuneUp Kit for frame rate is if it's not an OpenGL app. So it's good for games. It would not be good for a social media app or something that's not using OpenGL.
Yeah.
Do
you have to install Snapdragon on your phone also?
No, you don't. Yeah, I guess I always forget to mention this, but you can use Snapdragon Profiler with any commercial device that has a Snapdragon chip on it. Maybe I'll do it right now. Yeah.
How much impact does running these monitors have on the app itself?
It depends on what you're doing. Some things do have a pretty serious impact, but that's some really low-level instrumentation that we do. What I was just showing, it's really not that bad. 5%, roughly. It depends on the application too. So there's applications we'll work with that are a lot like the demo app that I have running, that are really maxing out, more gaming type applications, and enabling Profiler will show a small frame rate decrease with those apps, just because they're so resource hungry that adding anything additional kind of affects them. So it's the only time I really see any major impact, major being a few frames per second. But for the most part, we've profiled it at about 5% worst case scenario. But there are certain things that you can do that will slow down your frame rates or affect your app. But it's in the interest of giving you more data about what's actually going on. Is there a question there? So second row is Trace. I went ahead and brought it up. I restarted the app to get it back in unoptimized mode. So this Trace section is your standard A-Trace, Android SysTrace type data, so it's all the categories you should be familiar with. We also have DSP, so these are all the, if you ever get into it, these are all the DSP counters that you can access, and it's a good 110 different data points. I can't tell you what all those mean, because I don't know. I'm not a DSP expert, but it's useful for people that are doing development with that chip. So I got that demo running. I'm going to select it. And when I select it, we get per process trace data now. What I had mentioned, we start with Android SysTrace supporting all that, and what we're doing is building around things that you can't get out of Android SysTrace or any other tools. These are things that you can only get with Snapdragon chips, smart drivers. The DSP being a good example of that. You're not gonna get that with other profiling tools. These per process metrics are all GPU. This is a graphics application. And here, see like OpenGL-ES. So we have two metrics I call per draw call stages being one of them and rendering stages being another. This rendering stage is actually one of those that really grabs every bit of data out of the driver and has a massive impact. And the amount of data that it grabs is insane. This per draw call stages though lets me see basically the full pipeline that's going on in the driver, the graphics driver. And the nice thing is it's correlated with all the other data that you get from Android SysTrace and any other metrics that you select. Something we recently added is being able to see actual counter metric data. For instance, I just selected the GPU clocks, so I can see what are the clock cycles of the GPU at this finite time frame. So the app's running, I'll go ahead and start the capture and stop it, and it'll take a second, so that was fast. Usually takes longer than that. So we have the data. We're working on this little problem here. We got this big gap of data here between all the Android SysTrace and our GPU data. But here on the bottom, say the bottom half, is data that's coming out of our graphics, our graphics driver for the GPU. All this is Android SysTrace. So anybody familiar with Unity Engine? Game Engine? Okay. So this is a Unity app, and that nice bright neon green is the main thread for Unity executing. And you can see it is hopping across the cores a little bit, but it is getting decent execution time on each. The brown here is the worker threads. Unity also has an audio thread that runs. So standard Android SysTrace, if you're familiar with that tool, then all this data that's on the screen right now should be familiar. So down in the bottom, though, and I'll actually go ahead and just highlight that. Down on the bottom, and starting with kind of this trace process, that's your Android SysTrace data, and going below that is the data coming out of the driver. So I can zoom in on this section here and see each of the surfaces. So the surfaces are basically, you know, the array of pixel data that's going to get rendered to the screen. And this particular application per frame looks like it has 5 surfaces. So one frame of data is basically from that green marker to the red marker here. Now what I marked up top here is EGL swap buffers, which is coming out of Surface Flinger. And that's what's actually sending it to the screen in simple terms. And you can see there is a slight difference, a slight lag between what's happening in the driver and what's happening in the Android system layers. So if I just look at this frame, I can see roughly how long it's taking to execute. It's roughly terrible frame time of about 56 milliseconds. Oops, sorry, it's kind of difficult to use a mouse in the way. 56, 57 milliseconds, which is really terrible frame time. You can see if I drill down even further, these stages, I won't go into it, but we have what's called a binning stage, which is kind of breaking up the display into all these chunks, and then the rendering pass where the actual rendering is being done and all the draw calls that are being made. So you can look at that on a per surface basis. You can look at it down at per draw call basis, and you can see how many GPU clocks each draw call is taking. So as a developer, I can drill in and see, okay, all these clocks kind of at the beginning of this timeline are taking up a very low amount. But then as I get over to draw call 6963, basically at 1.2 gigahertz, which is maxing out the GPU. So I can drill into, okay, for my frame, what is draw call 6963, dig into my code and see, maybe it's rendering the skybox, or maybe it's rendering the car, or something along those lines. It's just kind of an example of how you can use this information. As I said, just very detailed. The last one we have is called Snapshot. And this is, again, a bit more of a graphics thing, but just to give you an idea of what it does. So I'm going to go ahead and do a snapshot. And what it's doing right now is it's frozen on the device, it's capturing data, and once it's done capturing, it's going to transfer the data, and you're going to see a screenshot here. It's a very, very simple graphics demo. In the top right, as it's transferring, all the different textures that are being used to render the frame are there. I can view all the different data objects that went into it. I can look at a program and see the vertex and fragment shader that went into that, the statistics for it, and so on. And as a developer, this lets me basically debug what's going on. If I see any rendering artifacts, or maybe, like I said, draw call 6963, if I actually knew the code, I could figure out from here which draw call that is. I can double click on the draw call, find out exactly what part of the mesh that was. It'll flash here in a second. So those little yellow lines, that whole section was that particular draw column. So I can dig in and see exactly what's going on. In fact, just a quick look here. Oh, so that last draw call, it is the most expensive draw call, and what it is actually the blur. So this Unity by default renders the whole scene, and the very last thing they do is apply a very slight blur to the scene. That gives it kind of the special artistic effect to make it look a little better. Well, that blur, what we found out is actually really poorly written. And we were able to optimize it for them. They didn't accept the optimization, but that's not a problem. But that is actually, I remember now, that's actually why that draw call is so expensive. I can drill in further, I can double click a pixel. And when I'm doing all these operations, is actually going back to the device, communicating with the graphics driver, doing some tests, and then sending back the data. So that's why there's just a slight delay, but here in the top left, I can see the pixel that I selected, and probably zoom in a bit more on that. See the pixel I selected, and then see all the different draw calls that went into rendering that pixel. And you can see there's quite a bit of overdraw, quite a bit of things going on in order to get to that final color. And that's the gist of it.
So have you tried this with Maya?
With Maya?
Yeah.
I don't think Maya will run on the device, right?
Well, it won't run on a phone.
Right.
It's too big.
So we have artists in the group that I'm in, and they'll use Maya. I think actually they use Maya to build that little car. Mm-hmm. So some of the things that we've done in the past is actually build Maya plugins to optimize the data. So a lot of times with gaming and graphics in particular, it's not even so much about the software execution, it's the way the data is structured. So we'll, you know, there's a lot I can talk about there, but if the data is not structured very well, it's not going to go through the chip very well. And so developers have to consider that aspect.
My son does animation. He's burned out several machines. Rendering.
I saw a reference to the older VM, Dalvik, but the most recent runtime or VM is Art, right?
Mm-hmm.
So does it support that or planning to? And also, I was at the Google I/O conference 2 or 3 weeks ago, and they're all pushing, you know, Daydream later this year. Are you guys going to be having sort of VR support for this type of stuff?
Yes, we actually do have VR support. The cardboard apps work fine right now. Oculus, we've been working with them. We recently discovered a few bugs that their platform won't work with today's devices. But once a new OTA goes out, they'll work fine. We have VR uses with OpenGLES, it uses multiple contexts, basically multiple rendering threads. And one of the things that we can do is in this trace view. Now I won't do a new capture or anything, but you see the rendering stages for context, you know, hex. That hex is the thread ID. So, or context ID. So if you a VR app, what you would basically see is all this execution for each of the contexts that were created for, you know, the time warp thread and whatever other threads are going on with VR.
Are they moving over to Vulkan?
Yes, we have Vulkan support too.
What's the impact on like cardboard type apps, Samsung VR? What's the path of migration? Probably, I mean, the split screen testing is okay, but now we're going to get more pixels rather than GPU, we're going to get more overloaded, bigger demand on platforms that's been moving over the next couple of years.
Yeah, so we've been doing a lot with all of our partners with VR for a little while now. And kind of what's happening, Snapdragon 820 in particular, which is in the Galaxy S7 and a bunch of other devices this year, we're optimizing a lot of our software to help with, you know, the paths and the data sharing between all the different components. You know, VR isn't just CPU and GPU, it's, you know, all the sensors, the DSP. You know, I mentioned earlier the, you know, offloading to the DSP, that's one of the optimizations that a lot of the VR partners are using. We just launched the Snapdragon VR SDK, which also you know, has a lot of these optimizations for Snapdragon. So within Qualcomm, there's a heavy focus on optimizing all the data pathways between these components in the interest of making mobile VR more possible, I guess you could say. So I can't talk about, you know, what the future is, but there is a lot of work being done.
The same thing, like magically, and OEG and those other augmented reality players are, because that's completely different from VR, right?
The AR.
Now basically have a transparent lens and they can throw objects on top of that.
Yeah, there's. I guess I can just say that there's just a lot of interesting VR and AR, or whatever Magic Leap is calling it. You know, all these technical challenges are making the chips better. They're really forcing everybody to optimize the pathways. You know, things used to be barriers between all the components of the system on chip, you know, that Snapdragon is called.
What's the bottleneck right now? Current platform that we can buy today and over the next 2 years, what are the bottlenecks that in terms of the VR apps on top of hardware? It's hard to cook with processing DSPs.
I think it's these chips weren't designed for these use cases, and your cycle time, you know, the chips that are being designed today aren't coming out for 2 or 3 years. So this general cycle time, you know, just takes time to catch up. But the changes that are being made are to better support these things. I think in general, you know, you're gonna see, you know, power thermal is gonna be always around with mobile. And that's definitely one of Qualcomm's strengths, is in finding optimizations for power and thermal.
Yeah. Samsung VR stuff, 15 minutes of just an experience and editing, it's cookie. Any device that I throw into it, it's just like 15 minutes, you're like, wow, it's hot.
Yeah.
And then the battery drain is like that.
Yeah, and you know, just from even like looking at it with Profiler, looking at these apps, it's just because they're using everything. You know, they're maxing out the processor. And by processor, I mean Snapdragon, which is actually composed of 20 processors. So, you know, they're using everything they have, and of course, that's just going to drain the battery. It's going to raise up the temperature, and that's where tools like Profiler, you know, we're trying to get out there for developers to let them know, you know, there are things to not do. It's already bad enough. Don't make it worse. Sort of thing.
They were talking about frame rates of 120.
Yeah,
standard for VR.
That's the belief.
Yeah. I mean, resolutions are going to get much higher than what we see today. Okay. A couple of years ago, people were saying, you know, no one needed a 500 ppi screen, and no one's saying that anymore. Just put on a VR headset.
Yeah. Enthusiastic.
So does the tool actually help you resolve conflicts between writing directly to the driver or using the operating system, or, you know, going through Unity? And the second question would be, does this optimization tool tell you how much more you need to reduce your footprint in order to run on certain chipsets?
The first question, does it help with, I guess, basically knowing where the bottlenecks are at? whether you're using it with Android or with Android.
Right, if you have multiple threads and you've got one using your driver, one using, you know, Google's and...
To an extent, there was something that came up this past week, actually, where we were noticing issues within issues is a wrong word. We're noticing things happening inside the Android system. And it was affecting performance, but there was nothing that anybody could do about it because it was all internal Android. You could see it through profile. It wasn't immediately obvious. And that's something that I'm hoping we can take care of to help people identify things faster. But after some digging, that's kind of what it came down to.
And do you Google that feedback so that they can make those changes?
Yeah.
Fix it for Android N.
Yeah.
Before it launches.
Yeah, we work very closely with Google and others with these things.
And then on that optimization piece?
Yeah, so the timeline, can't remember the exact question.
So if you're using the optimizing tool, you can see how much of a footprint you're having on CPU, heat, battery. Does it tell you, in a way that's easy to grasp, how much more optimization you need to do to be able to run on, you know, three generations back?
No, but that's a great idea. But you would, it could tell you, but you would need to basically do it yourself and then look at the timing information. So,
yeah. You see some of these bottlenecks transferred to the server side in the case of VR, for example, you know, because there is a limit of GPU and battery consumption that you can have in the VBox itself. So do you see this kind of optimization?
On the server side?
Yeah.
Pretty
much using the network to balance that, so you don't drain all your battery.
Yeah, I've never seen anybody do that successfully. Yeah. Just because I think the resolution's gonna be limited too over the network as far as how much. I'm sure it's possible, but
Latencies.
Yeah, in a past life, I worked in simulation. We used VR playing with VR since like 2000. And I personally got sick one time because of latency. And I can't believe that more people aren't getting sick with the devices that are out today. It's just, latency needs to be down to like 10 milliseconds or something around that range. There's not a lot of good VR content that's optimized these days. There's a lot of stutter, and the average person's gonna get sick off that.
There's actually a pretty good white paper we did on VR for anyone who's interested in some of the issues with the commercial things that are out there and what we're doing to solve it. If anyone comes up, we'll give you a card, you send me an email, I'll send you a white paper.
So the tools and the SDK that you talked about today, are they all free for
developers? Everything you're seeing.
And then what versions are they? Version 1, 2?
It depends on the product.
So Snapdragon Profiler's been out, it'll be a year next month. On secondary, I broke it.
You can save
there
the profile
if
you play
information.
You can save the information.
We release roughly every 68 weeks a new release. So. You know, Profiler, we're trying to improve it as fast as we can. So, what was the question?
Yeah, the new camera apps that are showing video and live.
The 360.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are they CPU intensive?
Stitching is extremely CPU intensive.
Yeah, they're looking at using GPU to do a lot of computation. Thank you.
Can you profile?
There's something that looks like the DSP too.
Do you have something that profile says?
Well, you could use either of these tools. In fact, we've been working with a number of different companies that are making 360 cameras. And I won't mention a name, but there was one example where this thing was not using hardware encoding. They had a reason why they didn't want to use that. And as a result, after a minute, they saw the temperatures rise, and then they saw the frame rates drop. Finally, their goal was, I think, 30 frames a second, and after like 5 minutes, it was at 17 frames a second, which was unacceptable. So using Symphony, they were able to basically, the solution was very simple. They said, use the four littles and two of the big ones. Because four of the little only gave a frame rate of like 24 fits. Mm-hmm. They needed 30. Two of the bigs brought it at 30, it never dropped, and the temperature basically was fixed. So there's definitely, that's a good use case where you need this, and it's fairly easy to address the issues.
So you can run big and small processors at the same time on the A20? I thought you had to do one or like, okay.
I don't know how the scheduler, I don't think they're actually running, it depends on the processor, it varies.
I think it does.
But the scheduler is juggling it. The nice thing about Symphony is you actually have control of the scheduler. You can override the default scheduler, which gives you a lot of things you can do. There's also power APIs where you can say, I care about battery life, give me this power efficient API, performance is all I want. So there's a lot of different control you have over things.
Yeah, I know the VR app that used Symphony to, they're having a performance issue with doing what's called sensor fusion. It's basically taking all the accelerometer data and calculating orientation for your head. And it came down to the scheduler was preventing the execution from being better. So they use Symphony to give it max power for a very, very short duration, just long enough to do all the calculations that they needed to do. I'm sorry, it was the time warp thread that was talking about. Yeah, so sensor fusion was offloaded, DSP, that was the other optimization. So yeah, the time warp thread, intense calculation, and it was a scheduler, because the scheduler was trying to keep power levels at a certain point. And so they used Symphony to give you all the power you got for these few milliseconds or microseconds, do the calculation, and then ramp it back down. And that's an example of how you can use these SDKs to kind of get a little better control and get that performance you want without totally killing the device. Yeah.
Do you need Windows to run the reports without just running on Mac?
I'm sorry.
Do you need Windows machine?
Windows? No, you can. We have this for Linux and Mac as well.
It's worthwhile to say that it doesn't necessarily have to be a Snapdragon processor for some of these features. The ones that we can support with TuneUp Kit, we do. Obviously, we can't read off maybe some of the GPU stats or thermal stats. Not every processor will give us access to that data, but we don't block other processors. We display all the data we can. So I think we've got time for one or two more, and then we can deal with our prize giveaway, and then anyone who wants to come up afterwards for other stuff just to come up, and we can continue to take additional questions. So, yes, we'll go back.
Okay, I had a question for you.
Sure.
Why would Snapchat consume more resources than, say, viewers?
That's a good question. You know, Kevin talked some about polling. That's a problem we see on a lot of apps, where they poll at a more frequent duration than they need to. We talked a little bit about managing the cellular radio. Every time you bring that up to the full power state, it actually takes, I believe it's around 12 seconds for it to drop down to the next state. It's called long tail, where when you bring it up, it takes a long time for it to kind of come back. So if you're continually polling, and it may not even be your app, I have probably 100 apps on my phone, maybe more like 200. Each one of those apps is polling. So you get into a situation where the processor rarely goes to sleep, the cellular radio rarely goes to sleep. Google, two years ago at I/O, they had job schedulers, a way to group your packets together and use the radio in a more efficient manner. There's Battery Historian, which is a great way to see if you're waking up, keeping the processor awake. Also, other things like that. I mentioned AT&T Aero, fantastic tool for watching things like that.
They're doing more than the next release of Android. The next release of Android's going to even have more.
Yeah, every time. Yeah. Yeah, they definitely have not solved the power and battery life and all those issues. Two more quick questions. Yes.
Have you run any of these tools against the Google Drive? It's data intensive.
I've done a couple of things on Google Drive. From my experience, Kevin might have a different view. Like I was doing AT&T Zero with Google Search, and then I was doing it with other pages. Google Search was pretty well behaved. Other pages had problems with not compressing textures. Other pages were doing redundant calls. You know, there was a lot of things that were flagged with AT&T Zero app. Generally, Google sites are pretty well behaved. In fact, I think I've done a tune-up kit with Google Drive, and it looked pretty good. But again, you want to compare it with OneDrive or another app of the same category, apples for apples. So, yes.
What do you think is the future in terms of battery technology? Because battery technology really hasn't changed for the past however many years, and it's more so that apps and devices are becoming a lot more efficient, but the actual technology in the battery has been pretty stagnant.
Yeah, so we've seen processor cores go from 2 to 8. We've seen screen resolutions quadruple. We're certainly not over yet. It's going to continue to go up. Rumor has it the next Samsung phone will be a 4K display. Sony had a 4K display a year ago. With VR, you know, don't be surprised to see 4K per eye. Seriously, it's a question of not if, it's a question of when. And then of course devices are getting thinner. So now you have less space for the battery, and that's why we, as hardware manufacturers and software developers, need to get better at doing what we're doing, using power efficiently, not wasting it, being aware. Until recently, no one had any idea how much power their app was even using. So how could you be, if there's an issue, how could you even know about it? And then once you know it's there, there's certain things you can do to fix it. We talked about using the DSP instead of the CPU. Right now, all the VR solutions are using the CPU for sensor fusion to merge all the sensor data. That's not a very power efficient way to do it. So there's a lot of things you can do that are available. Using the GPU more, and of course processors are going to get much, much better. Every time they get more efficient. So I don't think there's a silver bullet. I don't think we'll see a dramatic change in battery technology in the next 2 or 3 years. So we have to get more efficient in other ways. Yeah, one more.
Solar batteries?
Well, that's been around for a while. I mean, there's
have the screen be the solar.
There's been solutions that are out there. They're out there now. They're not very efficient. They're very slow charging.
Okay.
I think there's other things that might be better for that. So, the last question.
I was pushing up power amplifier upgrades. If you go from the 4, 6, or sometimes 9 PAs that are on a device down to 1 or 2, does that create complexity or eliminate complexity for the apps?
Well, most of it, I think, is transparent in terms of for the software developer, right? In terms of all the modem. And there's a lot of new technologies, gating and clamping and turning things off. And we have a power summit every year, and we not only talk about processor, we talk about motor and all this stuff. There's tons of things happening. There's not just clocking things down. There's so many different solutions to produce power. Every year I think Apple gets better, we get better, I'm sure. Intel and everyone else is getting better. So, and we're definitely not done. We need to continue to get better. So I think that's probably a good, anyone who has additional questions, definitely come up. We'll be around for a little bit. And just want to thank everybody for coming. Really great audience, great questions. So, and then if you asked a question and you're interested in a prize, please come up afterwards.
Give you guys a round of applause.